As we continue to explore morphology in American Sign Language, we come to the topic of fingerspelling. Now, at first, fingerspelling might not seem like a phenomenon that has much interaction with the concept of morphology. But on further analysis, it turns out that lots of morphological processes are actually happening with fingerspelling. Now, when we use the term fingerspelling, we have to be careful because the term is somewhat ambiguous. There's traditional fingerspelling, where there's an English word that ASL does not, ASL may or may not have a sign for, but that I want to convey using English letters. So if I want to talk about photosynthesis, since there's no readily available sign that succinctly shows that idea, then I might spell the word photosynthesis, and I'm going to basically spell the English word. Now, sure, there might be some letters in the middle that are somewhat blended together, but for the most part, you're going to see the entire English word, photosynthesis. Now, if it turns out that I'm fingerspelling that word a lot, maybe in a biology class that's being taught to a group of deaf students, or through a sign language interpreter who's interpreting a biology class, then as that word is used more and more in that particular context, then that word can become what's called a nonce, which means it's a fingerspelling that is used only in that particular context, in such a way that if somebody were to walk in and see the word photosynthesis fingerspelled after 3 weeks of the biology class, then a deaf person who has not been in that biology class would say, wait, what word was that? Because the word would have undergone some changes that would make it difficult for an observer on the outside to see. Not only would it be fingerspelled more quickly, but the movement of the word, the formation of the letters would themselves be affected by their use again and again in that class. And then, of course, we have some fingerspellings that have undergone so many changes that they've actually become their own individual signs. Think of the sign back, for instance, where most signers sign that sign in a way that you only see the B and the K. There's no formation of the A and the C in that word. Just the B and the K are formed, and they're formed in various ways depending on whether you're moving away or moving toward the location, so that the sign back can be formed in lots of different ways. It almost doesn't even resemble fingerspelling anymore. And that's called lexicalized fingerspelling. So let's take a look at these. Now, first we have to recognize that in all forms of fingerspelling, the configuration, that is, the movement between letters, is much more important than simply looking at individual letters. Now, this is why people who are reading fingerspelling read it as shapes rather than as individual letters. Notice that there are some letters that are much easier to see, letters that are high up, like B, where the fingers are extended, or W, where the fingers are extended. Letters that turn downward, like P and Q. Letters that are to the side, like H and G. And letters that move, like J and Z, are easy to see. And so they're going to stand out. Smaller letters, like A and E and S and T, are going to be much more difficult to see. This is the same for English speakers when they're reading cursive, for instance. It's easy to spot a T in cursive because it's a high letter and it's crossed. It's more difficult to spot an S versus an I. Well, an I might be easier because if the person dots the I, but more difficult to see the difference between an E and an S in many people's cursive handwritings because they're so small. So keep in mind that when you're reading fingerspelling, if you're trying to see individual letter, as if you're going to say the letters to yourself while you're watching the fingerspelling, then you are doing the wrong thing. If I were to try to spell English words to you quickly, you would have a hard time understanding. Like photosynthesis, for instance, if I just started P-H-O-T-O-S, you would say, wait, whoa, I can't do that. You have to hear all the letters together. If you see it written, that's one thing. You see the entire shape. And it's the same with fingerspelling. You need to focus on the entire shape rather than on trying to see each individual letter. So, that's important with traditional fingerspelling. Now, it's important that your hand stays steady. There's no bouncing or extraneous movements that are added. Each letter is represented, even if only slightly. The hand doesn't need to move out to the right as some novice signers tend to do. And notice that there are special repeated configurations that might come up. when you have a double E or a double or an ing, for instance, that comes up repeatedly, then you'll notice that there's a certain movement, even in traditional fingerspelling. But for the most part, traditional fingerspelling is going to show you every letter. This is used whenever you have a word that comes up or a name that comes up that's not being used in conversation before. Now, a nonce, on the other hand, is a faster representation of the fingerspelling that includes phonological processes. Just as with other phonological with signs, where holds can be omitted, where contacts can be omitted, where you can have assimilation, the shape can change before, depending on the letters before or after it. So with a nonce, you see these phonological processes occurring to a much greater degree. Now, it's hard to say what the line is between traditional fingerspelling and a nonce. If a person comes up to you and says, "Hi, my name is Sue," well, Sue's a really common name, so most people are not going to spell it, you know, slowly and clearly. Instead, they're going to spell it pretty quickly, and the U and the E are going to be assimilated so that the E only looks like it's made with the first three fingers, the thumb, the index finger, and the middle finger. And that's okay, because Sue is a common English name. Whereas if a person came up and said that their name were Javier, which is a much less common English name, then it'll probably be fingerspelled a little slowly. So remember, the line between traditional fingerspelling and nonce is not a firm line. But with nonces, you see more of these phonological processes occurring as the letters, quote-unquote, blend together. Sometimes letters are omitted, but you'll still notice the first and the last letter clearly, and you'll still notice that the high and the low letters and the letters that move stand out so that you're able to focus on the overall shape of the word. Again, nonces are meant to be understood by people who already know what they mean. So don't feel bad if you walk into the middle of a conversation and you don't understand what the fingerspelled word is. Perhaps that fingerspelled word has already come up three or four times and all of the letters are not being represented. Sometimes students are harder on themselves than they need to be because, in fact, even a native signer would maybe have trouble understanding what that fingerspelling is. And of course, with nonces being used again and again, they can become lexicalized fingerspelling. The sign job, for instance, was probably fingerspelled so many times that eventually it lost the characteristics of fingerspelling and took on the characteristics of a sign. This is just like any other compounding event, where instead of having the individual letters, the letters are compounded together in and become one sign. Matter of fact, the term lexical means a word or relating to a word. So lexicalized fingerspelling is fingerspelling that has become a signed word or a sign. So job should not be fingerspelled J-O-B. That is the fingerspelling of the word job. But when we see in written gloss this hashtag, we mean the sign that is used this way, job. Car, back, early, all of these lexicalized fingerspellings that have become so prevalent now in sign language started out as traditional fingerspellings, became nonces that were widespread, and through the phonological and morphological processes that we've talked about, eventually became their own unique signs.